Hello and welcome, you're watching To The Point. A series of ominous developments have focused national attention on the Ladakh incursions and their implications for India-China relations. So tonight we ask, what does the Chinese president mean when he asks his army to prepare for regional war? Why did our army chief cancel his visit to Bhutan? And what's the message behind incursions in Chumar and Demchok? That's the discussion in part two. But first, the BJP Shiv Sena have sealed an alliance, and we are waiting to find out if this will propel Congress NCP to do the same. But behind this facade of unity, are there still troubles ahead for the BJP Shiv Sena? And can electoral desperation push Congress NCP to overcome their differences and seal a deal? The outcome of the Maharashtra elections could depend critically on both those questions. That's the first debate tonight. And now joining me to discuss the developing political situation in Maharashtra is the associate editor of The Hindu, Smita Gupta, the renowned Asian Age columnist Ashok Malik, the well-known Mint columnist Akar Patel, and the senior journalist Mahesh Vijapurkar. Akar Patel, the BJP Shiv Sena alliance has survived, and the reports suggest that the Shiv Sena could fight 151 seats with the BJP contesting 130. In your eyes, does this put the alliance in pole position, and do you now believe they are the most likely to win the elections?
I think they are, and I think the major problem of the alliance has been sorted out. We might have another problem further down the road when they are close in terms of the number of seats and they might have to fight it out over who becomes CM, but I don't think that's going to happen. The history of the last 20 years is that the BJP tends to get about 4.5 seats out of every 10 that it fights. The Shiv Sena only wins about 3. If it's, for instance, in 2009, the Sena fought on 41 more seats but lost 2 seats more than the BJP did. I think that what is likely to happen, given a 131-150 number, is that the BJP will have more seats than the Sena, and it might probably have the next CM.
Ah, well, that's very interesting. I'll come to that in a moment's time. But before I come to that particular issue, Ashok Malik, I want to put something else to you. After the acrimony through which we've been through, with both sides at one point actually preparing to contest all 288 seats themselves, how united is the alliance they've pulled off this morning? Or do you see a large potential for what I might call disruptive rebel candidates in both camps, i.e. Shiv Sena and BJP?
Well, there'll certainly be a tussle. I'm not sure there'll be rebel candidates against each other. As in, I'm not sure the Shiv Sena and the BJP will put up rebel candidates against each other. But there will be a keen tussle to finish number one, in the sense that the Shiv Sena will want to win more seats, desperately want to win more seats than the BJP, because the Shiv Sena wants the chief ministry. It doesn't want to be junior partner in a state where it used to be the senior partner. And in case the BJP wins many more seats, and in case, as Akar suggested, the BJP's strike rate is way better than the Shiv Sena's and it wins more seats, then Uddhav Thackeray can't become chief minister, and that would be a setback for him, because for the first time someone from the Thackeray family has expressed a desire to be chief minister. So in that sense, the BJP has got what it wanted. It wanted 135 seats and it ended up getting 130, which and it is quite likely the BJP will win more seats. I guess power has this is a great glue and will bring the parties together if and when they win the election. But yes, there will be a tussle, internal tussle in the alliance to finish number one.
Mr. Vijapurkar, let me first put this thought to you, that this alliance, now that they've actually sealed the deal, is in pole position. Do you accept that within the alliance, the BJP has the advantage, its advantage BJP?
It could have had a sharper advantage had the seat arrangements worked out the way it was sought to be. Because all along, the arrangement that has been sought to be worked out has been on the basis of arithmetic and not political. A political alliance, especially during election time, has to necessarily have people discussing seats, candidates, the opportunities to win, the possibilities of losses. But these are things that have not been gone into. It's just that they're looking at the possible hit rate, the success ratios, and who would get the most. That's why this tussle for 151 plus 130. If this is something that is out of the way, then we see that the two parties are likely to be positioned quite close to each other. There's no doubt about it.
When you say quite close to each other, you're actually then suggesting it's not really advantage BJP.
I would say it is advantage BJP generally, but if you put a very precise point to it, if the Modi factor does work and all boats rise together in the same tide, then it could be a close finish.
All right.
And that's one reason. I think the Shiv Sena is insisting on that arithmetic of having 50% plus one as the alliance seat share in the assembly as victors, and BJP to have one seat less than the Sena has.
Okay.
And beyond that, nothing else matter. This is not politics. This is not a political arrangement. This is sheer arithmetic.
Smita Gupta, there's a very good point made there by Mr. Vijay Purkar that a rising tide lifts all boats. But the BJP does believe that when they look at the Lok Sabha results, and when they sense that what they still believe continues a Modi wave, that they are going to end up with a better strike rate. And you heard Mr. Patel actually argue very convincingly that their track record in Maharashtra elections has always been better as well. So do you accept Mr. Patel's wider point that on top of advantage BJP, you could see the BJP having more seats, perhaps significantly more seats than Shiv Sena?
The BJP may end up with more seats if the Modi factor continues to work in Maharashtra. But I take Mahesh's point more seriously that, you know, that there is that kind of emotional connect BJP and Sena seems to be missing. So, and both Shiv Sena and the BJP will be working to ensuring that the other party wins less seats. So, I don't think, it's so easy to predict which of the two parties will be ahead.
And you're also suggesting that there's a natural inclination, even if they keep it hidden, that they will work against each other's interests just to ensure that they themselves come out number one.
Yeah, because you see, the reason why there was no reason for them to go together, except the arithmetic demands that if they go together, they have a better chance. Of the two alliances, the BJP Sena and the Congress NCP, of course, the BJP Sena is the alliance that is likely to win an election. So it would have been extremely foolhardy for them to have gone separately, but There isn't that kind of there is after the death of Gopinath Munde in Maharashtra, the BJP lacks a sort of all Maharashtra leader. His daughter has kind of stepped into the breach, but she doesn't have the kind of experience or the kind of backing that her father had. And there is no leader in the BJP who has that kind of connection with Uddhav Thackeray or any of the Sena leaders.
Which makes it a much weaker alliance in terms of chemistry, but strong in terms of arithmetic. Akar Patel, I want to pick up on the point that you suggested could be the
arithmetic
rupture point that lies ahead. If, as you expect will be the case, the BJP ends up with more seats, how likely is it that a victorious BJP, having achieved its goal of winning more seats, will actually insist on the chief minister's job? And will they insist to the point where they end up offending Uddhav Thackeray and the Shiv Sena and possibly creating a second point of rupture? How far will they push that interest?
Well, if we look at the numbers post-1990, the BJP has always been about 3.5% in terms of votes in front of the Sena. Given the fact that only 20 seats separate them this time, I don't think that there will be occasion to have that fight. I think the difference between the BJP will be about 17-20 seats in the BJP's favor. And that should, I think, seal the argument. The other aspect is that the Shiv Sena is not a caste-based party. It's a party based on a charisma of one man who is no longer with us, a very bright speaker, a very good speaker. Think of him as a stand-up comic who built an audience over the decades without any kind of support in terms of caste that the other parties have. I think this has dissipated to a large extent with his son, who's dullish, not particularly charismatic. The reason he surrendered on the number of seats, which the old man would never have done, was that he was afraid of this very thing, that given the difference in the number of seats that the BJP wins versus the number that the Sena wins, it is very likely, and I think it is going to happen, that he's going to lose out on being CM.
So the corollary to your answer also, Akar Patel, is that when the BJP ends up with more seats, there won't be much resistance to the BJP taking the chief minister's job. Uddhav Thackeray, in a sense, through the statements he's making today where he says he's not actually interested in the job, is suggesting he's not going to fight for it either.
I think the numbers will make sure that that argument doesn't even come up. The reason why the BJP surrendered to the Sena as many seats as they have over the last 2.5 decades is not because they needed the Sena very much, but because the Sena helped them in the Lok Sabha. I think it was Mahajan's move to Delhi, particularly in 2004, where the BJP kept on surrendering the assembly segment to the Sena and getting more seats in the Lok Sabha. I don't think that holds anymore. I think the BJP is a national party, particularly in Western India. It's much more powerful in that state than the Shiv Sena is. I think that this is the one election where the dynamics of the alliance will change. Permanently.
Ashok Malik, I'm going to put that very same question to you, because your understanding of the internal dynamics of the BJP and its aspirations and its thinking is perhaps better than anyone else I know. Do you believe that the BJP will definitely take the chief minister's job if it's even just one seat ahead of Shiv Sena? Is there a critical number of seats that the BJP wants to be ahead before it risks annoying Uddhav Thackeray? Or are they so keen that even with just one seat's difference, they'll grab the job?
You know, if it's just one seat ahead, there will be a tussle. But if it's 10 or 17 seats ahead, as 17 or 20 seats ahead, which is the number Akar Patel used, then I have no doubt that BJP will take the chief minister's job and insist on taking it. Because you need to go back to Modi's election. One of the principles on which the BJP ran the recent election campaign was that winning allies adding to the NDA's tally and took its toll on the BJP's organic growth in key states. In Andhra Pradesh, for instance, where it had a head start, but then lost out once it tied up with Chandrababu Naidu in the late 90s and in several other states. And it is determined this time to not disturb that organic growth. In Maharashtra, particularly after the death of Bal Thackeray, it sees the Shiv Sena as a waning force. And the BJP sees itself as a rising force. That is the BJP's perception. It's perhaps borne out by electoral numbers in recent years. The BJP would not want to surrender that advantage.
Mr. Vijayapurkar, let's now flip to the other alliance, the Congress NCP. After the BJP and Shiv Sena have successfully stitched up a deal and placed themselves in pole position, isn't it imperative for Congress and NCP to stay united and stick together? Because otherwise, they face certain defeat.
To the Congress and the NCP, it ought not to matter whether they stay together or not, to combine the of the BJP and the Shiv Sena, mainly because they are in that to just return a brief small position in the assembly. The game seems to be so tilted against the Congress and the NCP that it doesn't much count whether they are together or not. It would make sense to be together, yes. But I suppose Maharashtra in fact needs a situation where all the four parties fight against each other and let the state know where each of the parties stands vis-a-vis voter support. In an alliance politics, you have this serious problem of a voter wanting to vote for A party but being forced to vote for the B because A and B are alliance partners. Since the last 25 years of the alliance being in place, we just don't know how actually, intrinsically, each of the political, political parties stands to gain.
Can I interrupt you there?
Coming back to your point.
Before you come back to my point, can I interrupt you? You're absolutely right. Were they to fight separately, they would have a much clearer idea of where they stand in the voters' list of preferences. But at this moment in time, does either Congress or the NCP want to hear that brutal truth? Surely what they want is a certain cover-up to the reality to ensure that it's not as depressing and not as clearly revealed to be depressing as otherwise it would be. They don't want the truth known, surely, at this point of time.
Of course they wouldn't. After all, the political situation in Maharashtra is such that the Congress and the NCP have been pushed into a situation of having to play act, that they are two political parties that they count.
Quite right.
And beyond that, what role do you expect to see them perform?
Quite right. Smita Gupta, let me bring you in on that point. This morning, after their first meeting, Congress and NCP were unable to agree on an alliance. There are some reports that thereafter, in fact, the NCP has, in fact, stepped up their demands. I don't know how reliable those reports are. But we are meeting again at 8:30. That's literally in about 15 minutes' time, and they're probably going to meet again tomorrow. Do you believe that because the alternative could be political suicide, they're going to have to agree to a deal?
I think so, because I think the battle for the Congress NCP is not to win the election, but to stay remain relevant politically. But nevertheless, both parties, there's been so much bad blood between the two parties that they're still making demands, raising their demands. For instance, at this morning's meeting, the NCP has suddenly sprung two more demands in addition to the one that they had earlier made, the one for 144 seats, half the seats in the assembly. Now they're also asking for a chief minister by rotation, 2.5 years. And they're also asking, they've also asked the Congress that since some independents have joined their party, the Congress should give up a few of its sitting seats to the NCP. I don't know whether there's going to be a meeting tonight. That 8:30 meeting may have been cancelled, but certainly there will be a meeting tomorrow. So it is not clear at this stage whether the NCP is merely posturing to increase pressure on the Congress to increase the number of seats, because the Congress's last offer was 130, or whether the NCP feels that it really should go ahead and you know, try its luck on its own. Having said that, I would also add that at the most senior level, that is Sharad Pawar and Sonia Gandhi, I think they still would like an alliance. But there are younger elements in the NCP, such as the Deputy Chief Minister Ajit Pawar, who feels that, you know, that for 15 years they have sort of been in the shadow of the Congress party, and that it is time to break out.
Okay.
So, but I think the whole picture will become clearer within the next 24 hours.
You know, whilst there is confusion about what the NCP will do, Akar Patel, surely one thing has become clear today, and that is with the BJP Shiv Sena staying united, Sharad Pawar's options must have shrunk. He can no longer hope to forge a post-board alliance with the BJP. That's now clearly, I assume, ruled out. And clearly, fighting on his own without any support from Congress would be a disadvantageous way of entering the elections. So do you think events or developments have, in a sense, boxed Mr. Pawar into a corner?
He once said that Maharashtra was a Congress-minded state, and in that I think he meant something that he believes himself, that I don't think there is any option open to him intellectually himself or for the people in his party to join the BJP. I could be wrong about this, but I don't think I am. I think with the NCP Congress, the reverse situation obtains as with the Shiv Sena and the BJP. The national party, the Congress, tends to win fewer seats and a smaller percent of the votes on the seats that it fights than the local party, the NCP. Sonia Gandhi was pragmatic when, after Pawar broke away from the Congress on the foreign bond issue, she still went ahead and allied with the NCP in Maharashtra. I think what will happen is that we will see a similar sort of pragmatism. Even if it is not 144-144, I think given the way in which the NCP tends to score over the Congress per seat, it is possible and perhaps likely that the NCP will win more seats this time than the Congress. If that should happen, I don't see any reason why Mr. Pawar should have lost, and also I don't see any reason why the Congress can stop the NCP from having a CM.
Mr. Vijayapurkar, to what extent do you accept that analysis from Akar Patel that in fact this time around NCP is going to win more seats than Congress, and presumably that suggests that Congress's capacity to bargain hard tonight and tomorrow is diminished, not increased? And therefore, what response do you expect Congress to take? What position do you expect Congress to take in their discussions overnight and tomorrow?
Taking forward the lady's point of view earlier, that the two political parties, the Congress and the NCP, are striving to establish or retain the relevance in Maharashtra's politics, at least in the next 5 years, it would appear to me that it just would be a toss-up. It just doesn't matter which of the two parties scores more. It's not likely to be a phenomenally large difference between the two political parties. However, then the question of which political party would get the opposition leader's position does emerge. when Chagan Bhujbal, for instance, had quit the BJP, had quit the Shiv Sena, the BJP angled and jockeyed itself and strove and secured that position. It's all that important to have your person in a position. This is one reason why, again, you find that the sticking point between the BJP and the Shiv Sena was, I'm told, subject to confirmation, that the Shiv Sena has been anticipating a higher strike rate by the BJP and therefore sought an informal assurance that even if the BJP secures a larger number of seats than the Shiv Sena did, they would not make a claim for the chief minister's position.
Quite right. But we went down that discussion
if
earlier.
Come back to Congress and CP.
In terms of that alliance, which is still trying to weld itself together overnight, and it may carry on till tomorrow, how hard do you think Congress's capacity to push will be, given what Akar Patel said a moment ago, that NCP is likely to win more seats than them? Answer that for me quickly, please.
NCP is probably, I maintain that it's likely to be a toss-up. But the number of seats that the two parties would together win doesn't seem to be large enough for the BJP Shiv Sena to worry.
Therefore, I don't think that particular point counts at all. Yeah. Okay, I take your answer, except that I wasn't talking about NCP Congress worrying Shiv Sena and BJP. I was talking about the relationship between the two of them themselves. Ashok Malik, let's briefly, in the time left to us, widen our discussion. If the four big parties had actually fought separately, most analysts had concluded that would be bad news for Raj Thackeray and the Maharashtra Nav Nirman Sena. Now that the BJP Shiv Sena are going to be united, and it looks as if the Congress NCP could end up united as well, simply as a way of saving their skin, is that a breather for Raj Thackeray?
You know, Raj Thackeray has unfortunately lost out in the past few months and in the recent elections. He started off 5 years ago as a spoiler. In fact, he did help the Congress NCP alliance win the election the last time by cutting into the Shiv Sena BJP vote, especially the Shiv Sena vote. And at one point, the BJP was toying with choosing him over Uddhav Thackeray. But in recent months, especially with the Lok Sabha election and continuing into the state election, I think there is a perceptible bump in the BJP vote, which is carrying the BJP Shiv Sena to a probable victory. I don't think Raj Thackeray can make much of a difference. But if the four parties had fought separately, this point was made earlier about testing the individual strengths, I think the Shiv Sena would have been a big, big loser, because the BJP would probably have finished the single largest party by a long chalk, and the Shiv Sena's strike rate would have been very low without the backing of Mr. Modi, who is clearly a factor in Indian politics today.
Okay. Smita Gupta, this is clearly an important election for the BJP at many levels. Not only do they want to end up the single biggest, not only would they like to claim the chief ministership, but it's also going to be a reaffirmation after the by-election results suggested that the Modi wave was diminishing, that in fact it continues to be strong. Do you see Mr. Modi himself playing an extensive personal role in the campaign in Maharashtra?
I would imagine that both Mr. Modi and Mr. Amit Shah will put their best foot forward in Maharashtra. Maharashtra, not only because of its timing after the bi-polls, where the BJP hasn't done as well as it should have, but Maharashtra is a key state. It would consolidate the West, you know, Gujarat and Maharashtra. And Maharashtra has been in the hands of the Congress NCP for the last 15 years. So I think that they will put their best foot forward.
And that means fielding Modi as well. Am I right in that assumption?
Yeah, I think so.
Akar Patel, someone who also needs to prove his credentials, or shall I put it differently, his political credibility, is Rahul Gandhi. He failed to impress the country at the national elections in May. He played no role whatsoever in the by-elections that have happened thereafter, as a result of which people now joke that when Rahul doesn't campaign, Congress does extremely well. Do you believe that in some sense the Maharashtra campaign and the Maharashtra results are a test for Rahul Gandhi?
I don't think so, and I say this because I don't believe anybody in the Congress thinks that he is a serious factor, particularly in that state. The Congress, by whatever name we know it, has never lost in Maharashtra except once in 1995. So no matter what the Lok Sabha results may have thrown up in terms of assembly segments, there will be a belief in the Congress and the NCP that they have some sort of chance of winning. The other aspect is that this is the one remaining large state that the Congress has. To lose this would mean that a significant amount of funding going to Delhi and the National Party would end. I think that the Congress really needs to work hard to make sure that even if they lose Maharashtra, they don't lose it too badly and they have some hope of coming back in a short time frame.
Okay.
I hope that this is what's on Rahul Gandhi's mind. I don't know whether it is, but I think the Congress should be really worried about losing that state.
Very quickly, Mr. Mitapurkar, I'm going to ask you for a quick answer because we're running out of time for this half of the show. Undoubtedly, these would have been very exciting and tense elections if the four big parties had fought separately with the MNS as a fifth component. That doesn't look as if it's going to be the case. Nonetheless, will it still be tense and exciting, or do you think with defeat staring NCP Congress in the face, has some of the fun gone out of the election campaign?
I think the steam has already gone out of the Congress and the NCP. They'll have to work very, very hard to even get back into the campaign, because the time has been lost even to get ready for filing their candidates' nominations. And that's, of course, applies to the BJP Shiv Sena as well. But I don't think the Congress and the NCP are in the game to win these elections at all.
Okay.
They would be at best nominally present.
Would you agree with that, Ashok Malik, that the most exciting thing about the Maharashtra campaign has been the last 3-4 days as we wondered whether the alliances will survive and what outcome will be the nature of the alliances, and that hereafter, now that we know the answer to that, it's a near run done thing, we all know the outcome. Has it lost excitement? A quick answer.
Well, as a political obsessive, I was looking forward to a four-way fight. It would have been fun. As things stand, I think this is becoming a predictable election.
You agree with that, Smita Gupta? A predictable election, and therefore one that journalists may not perhaps pay as much attention to as they would otherwise?
Yeah, it's going to be a predictable election. I agree with Ashok, because with both the alliances in place,
okay,
the kind of anti-incumbency, the mood there, it looks set.
All right, even your diminishing voice suggests that already a sense of boredom about the outcome has crept into our journalistic sentiment and analysis. But may I add, for the sake of the audience, when journalists think something is predictable, they are quite often wrong. So don't let the journalists on this show convince you that you know the outcome of the polling. Polling day can always throw up surprises. The Indian voter is often the victor. My thanks to all four of my guests for joining me.